You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter, where every day is casual Friday. That means Monday is casual Monday. Tuesday, casual Tuesday. Wednesday, casual hump day. Thursday, casual Thurs. That's what we call it. And Friday, casual Shabbat. The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Friday, October 12th, 2018. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. It's Casual Friday, folks. Joining us on the program this week, Heather Parton, or Digby, from the blog Hullabaloo and Salon. Also on the program today, straight from his eBay page, Matthew Film Guy will be joining us, ostensibly to give us a film recommendation for the weekend. Meanwhile, also on the program, Turkey claims to have audio and video of the Jamal Khashoggi killing, and they have apparently shared it with the U.S. NAACP to sue Brian Kemp, Secretary of State of Georgia, in his vote rigging plan for his own election. Convenient, that. Meanwhile, Chuck Schumer does it again. 15 Trump judges get a free pass.
You're going to lose so much, you'll get sick of it.
And Democratic governor's races looking pretty good in Ohio and Wisconsin. And Georgia and Florida are within reach. Court case reveals that Bannon and Kobach added that census question to intimidate immigrants. 11 people dead in the wake of Superstorm Michael. And a climate change denier confirmed to lead the DOJ's environmental division. Meanwhile, Melania Trump, Kanye West battle it out for the most bullied person in the world.
Very bullied.
And a reminder, our immigration policy is tantamount to terrorism. All that and more on today's program, ladies and gentlemen. Casual Friday. I am sitting here. I am wearing a soft collared shirt and Zumbas today. Wow. Yep, I'm feeling very cash. And so I wonder if people. I guess everybody else is feeling a little cash around here too. Another week, ladies and gentlemen, and things get insane. You know, we were talking before, and we're not going to go into this too much, but we were talking before the program of what's going on in Brazil and Bolsonaro's folks. There was a protest. What was the protest called?
It was a Not Him protest.
Not Him protest.
It was a week before the election.
And this was the election, of course, that is not the final election, but the one that is going to lead to the runoff.
The first round, yes.
And there was a protest, Not Him, basically saying, hey, this guy's a fascist. We don't want him here.
And specifically a misogynist. It was woman. It was woman-centered mass demonstration of all people, but with a focus on his misogyny.
And so you had a lot of very sort of, I don't want to say banal, but typical women coming out looking like school teachers and moms and neighbors and, you know, doctors and
was not designed to look provocative or counterculture.
Right. It was, yeah, it was looking, trying to look normie, I guess would be the word. And apparently, I don't know who it was, Bolsonaro's people, put out pictures of a different protest called, what were the
fem? Well, they do, it, and we don't know, basically they disseminate it through these WhatsApp groups. And so it's people who support Bolsonaro. It seems like tactics definitely that, you know, Bannon's certainly at least connected to Bolsonaro's son. Bolsonaro denies that Bannon advises him, but, you know, whatever, there's a connection there. And they picked images from, I think it was Femin, is it called? But basically, those are they were popular. It was a big thing a couple years ago. Women from Eastern Europe who would go and protest events naked. There was also other pictures that they had just of, like, you know, public, like women, like, making out and stuff in public, things like that. And they sort of blasted it across these networks and said, these are the not him protests.
And so it's just, you know, on some level, a silly campaign of disinformation. On another level, a very effective campaign. And we see this increasingly in, you know, Fox News, where there's a lot of times where they put out a mistaken picture of, right, like, oh, these are the protests. And it turns out, no, those are not the protests. They do this often, and I don't know that they do it in a concerted way or if it's just an accident. We don't know. I mean, it's odd that it continues. But broadly speaking, I have a sense anyways that we are entering into an age where this is becoming more of a problem in this country, where the ignorance of people, and we have a video by Paul Ryan just talking about Medicare for All, which I think is in some ways a similar tactic. And certainly, I think, you know, there are, when you have a situation where the Secretary of State of a state like Georgia disenfranchises tens of thousands of voters for an election that he's running in, or when you have a Supreme Court that refuses to hear an appeal to a ruling by a court dominated by Republicans that will essentially throw an election in North Dakota, very, very possibly. And there's just no recourse. It's just one of those things that it's just, I don't know. It's a scary time. Very scary time.
Yeah. Can I just read you two things that this fucker said, this Bolsonaro guy?
Sure.
He said to a woman representative in Congress, "I'm not going to rape you because you're very ugly."
Yes.
He also said, "I'd rather have my son die in a car accident than have him dating a guy."
Right.
So,
really.
And that woman and that gay children should be whipped. I mean,
well, so there was clearly impetus for that protest. But the idea being is really more about the ability, right, to reinterpret for people who are, you know, for the average voter to reinterpret what the reality of any given protest is. This is good. So it's been a while since Eero advertised on this program, and I'm not sure if it's not because I have been continually pushing Eero to friends and family. And maybe, I don't know, maybe they saw, like, wait, why are we still getting all these links from the Majority Report code? The Eero home Wi-Fi system brings you fast, reliable connection in every room of the house. Second generation Eero and Eero Beacon allow you to build a Wi-Fi system that's perfectly tailored to the home more than ever before. In my apartment, I would come in and I would get, in some of my rooms, I would connect to my neighbor's Wi-Fi more than mine because it was so weak until I put my Eero in. When you add Eero Plus, you get a total network protection with the ability to block malicious unwanted content across your entire network. By checking the sites you visit against a database of millions of known threats, Eero Plus prevents you from accidentally visiting malicious sites without slowing anything down. Eero Plus automatically tags sites that contain violent, illegal, or adult content, so you can choose what your kids can and cannot visit right from the Eero app. Mila does not appreciate the fact that I shut down. I can shut down through my Eero app. I can shut down any device that she regularly uses. So her computer, her phone, they shut down at a certain time at night, and all of a sudden she has no Wi-Fi.
It's like you're the NSA.
It's true. I am her personal NSA. You can also get rid of annoying ads and pop-ups on all your devices. Ad blocking improves load time for heavy ad sites. You can browse and stream faster than ever before. I honestly love my Eero. I've pitched it to multiple people. Apartments. I mean, I don't know that many people live in houses, but I would imagine in a house, it's even that much more needed. The app is great. I can see all the devices that are on the Eero, and like I say, I cut my my daughter's access, and it's sort of fun. Get $100 off the Eero base unit in two Beacons package and a year of Eero Plus by visiting Eero, Eero.com/majority, entering code majority at checkout. That's Eero, Eero.com/majority, and code majority at checkout. Also, one of today's sponsors is newsvoice.com/majority. Look, we have increasing concentration of media. We all live in these epistemological bubbles where we only get the media that we self-select by via Twitter or Facebook or whatever it is. There's a new media company that's come up with their own response to these problems. It's called News Voice. It's an app for iOS and Android. You can access it for free if you go to newsvoice.com/majority, and it gives you a personalized news feed by aggregating a mix of mainstream media sources, international sources, and independent media sources. Multiple sources are provided for each news story, left and right. The entire app is fueled by crowdsourcing. You can upvote stories you think are important so people will see them. You can add stories to the app, or you can add a source that's missing for a story. It's meant to be a completely open and democratized news aggregator that lets you get every side of every story. They also have a video interview series featuring guests from like Chris Hedges to AOC. Go download the app for free at newsvoice.com/majority. Newsvoice.com/majority. If you're watching via YouTube, put the link under this video. And of course, we put the link in our podcast description as well. And finally, folks, just a reminder, Casper is a sleep brand that continues to revolutionize its line of products to create an exceptionally comfortable sleep experience one night at a time. They have three mattress models, the original Casper, the Wave, the Essential. Casper mattresses are perfectly designed to soothe and cradle your natural geometry. Not to mention, the breathable design helps you sleep cool and regulates your body temperature throughout the night. And it is delivered right to your door in a small, how-do-they-do-that size box with free shipping and returns in the U.S. and Canada. Free shipping! The best part, of course, of Casper is that you get to sleep on your mattress for 100 nights. Totally risk-free. You sleep on it, you don't like it, send it back.
No, thank you.
After all, you spend one-third of your life sleeping. You should be comfortable. Folks, you know I am also the proud owner of multiple Casper mattresses, as well as one that went to a relative of mine. So proof is in the pudding. I mean, I don't know what that means in the context of a mattress. But the fact of the matter is these are the most comfortable mattresses we have in our homes. Saul has one, and I have one at the satellite apartment. You know, I was able to get.
That's what it's called now.
That's what I call it.
The satellite apartment.
That's the one. That's the one. That, yeah, it's the satellite apartment. Well, people who have a similar situation as I do with separations understand.
I'm going to the satellite apartment. God damn it.
There's no context in which I would say that. Look, get $50 toward
you said
a select
the end of the show yesterday.
I did not say
yes,
that.
Yes, you did.
What?
You said we said, do you have Ring of Fire? You said, no, I'm going to the satellite department.
I did not say that. Get $50 towards select mattresses by visiting casper.com/majority and using majority at checkout. Why would I even say that in that context?
Why are you protesting so much?
I don't know. It's a very strange thing. Casper.com/majority. Offer code majority. Going to the satellite apartment for $50 off your mattress purchase. Terms and conditions apply. All right. This is... The race in Michigan is pretty tight, too, isn't it?
People need to get out there and vote for Whitmer. That's another crucial race right there.
It's, you know, Georgia, Florida, Michigan, Wisconsin, Ohio. These are huge, huge governor races that Democrats have a very good chance to pick up. These would all be pickups. And... Minnesota seems pretty safe right now. These are hugely important. I know everybody who listens to this program is going to vote, but make sure that you are aware of at least a half a dozen other people that you know are voting. I just came up with that metric. I don't know what that means, but it can't hurt.
It's like pay it forward, but for voting.
Exactly. In this guy, in Michigan... Whitmore is a pretty good candidate. She's not, she wasn't my choice in the primary. I don't vote there, of course, but, she's a pretty good candidate. And she's been endorsed by, I think, Bernie came in and is also, has campaigned on her behalf, I think. But she is running, in Michigan against this guy, Bill Shute. I don't know what position he holds now, but, the idea that a Republican could win the governorship in Michigan is just sort of disturbing based upon what we've seen of the Republican Party in the way that they have treated some of these cities, like Flint and whatnot. But
he's the attorney general.
He's the attorney general. And so Shute on Duty is his Twitter handle, which is just... and apparently American Bridge, which is a Democratic supporting PAC, got a hold of video from 1989. It's unclear where the video is from, but it was some documentary or industrial, or we don't know. But he is being interviewed, and the woman behind the camera asks him, "Could you move a little bit closer to the what they call in the business the practical? That is a light that was on camera." And so he shifts down and listen to how creepy this guy is. Not a flattering look for this guy, and I don't know. Let's make an assessment of it afterwards.
Would you please move closer to the lamp?
I would be happy to move closer to the lamp. I will do anything you want. Some things I may not let you run the camera on, but I will certainly happily.
Is one thing you try to...
It is no easy task. I admire your tenacity. Appreciate your spirit of Vincent van Gogh, Rembrandt, and Toulouse-Lautrec.
Oh my God.
That is
creepy.
Wow.
Creepy.
I can feel the douche chills going all down my spine right now.
It is unbelievable. It honestly, I feel like you could just sew this right into an episode of The Office, and it would totally fit in.
Except Carell's character was slightly less, like, evil or something. Like, there was something really... It wasn't, like, the unintended grossness of a doofus.
I like how he tries to impress her with, first off, she's saying, I just want to put you in a good framing, and... Clearly, the guy doesn't know any film references.
Van Gogh.
So he instead throws out like Art History 101. Van Gogh, Toulouse-Lautrec.
Oh, move closer to the light. Secret message received.
Yeah,
exactly.
They've been married for about 15 years now.
Who is that?
I was going to say it was like a cross between creepy like gonzo porn and Patrick Bateman. Like a gonzo porn starring Patrick Bateman.
Wait, who's Patrick Bateman?
The guy from American Psycho. But again, that guy was actually pretty smooth.
Yeah.
You have a great sense of mise-en-scene.
That would have been the actual...
Shoot looked like he was drunk off of his own horniness.
Yes, exactly. Like, I can't believe how turned
on
I'm right.
Shoot this so I can go masturbate.
No, the blood rushes away from your brain. Yes. They can't talk.
He was lightheaded because he was so horny.
He did seem like he was like high on a Percocet or something. Yeah. You know what I'm reminded of? I forgot about this until we played the clip. This guy tried to position himself, though, against Schneider in terms of what happened in Flint.
Of course.
He gave some like press conferences when that first broke about people going to jail and stuff. And I remember we played it on the show and we were like, is this guy really a Republican that he would come out swinging this hard on this? So he's definitely, I mean, this creepiness aside, and apparently I guess she's up 9 points in a poll, but he's been ahead of the curve in trying to do like, I'm not like all the other racist,
right,
criminal austerity Republicans.
I mean, as Attorney General, does he have any liability over what's been going on in that state?
He doesn't have liability. I mean, I think he's brought charges against some people with regards to Flint, but he did not take it to the top. He implied in that clip that he was going to take it at Schneider back then.
Right.
Well, he does have a history of coming out hard, so there we go.
Oh, God.
I appreciate your sense of mise-en-scene.
Yeah, yes, really tenacious.
Van Gogh.
So tenacious.
Rembrandt.
Van Gogh. I think that must be like a signal that I think he was a Woody Allen fan.
I
can't remember what movie it was.
Somebody should ask him if he's boofed yet, because I think he probably was boofing right there.
Oh, gosh. All right. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll be talking to Digby.
Satellites gone up to the skies. Things like that drive me out of my mind. I watched it for a little while. I like to watch things on TV. Satellite of love, satellite of love, satellite of love, satellite of love. Satellite's gone way up to Mars. Soon it'll be filled with park and cars. Watched it for a little while. I love to watch things on TV. Satellite of love, satellite of love, satellite of love, satellite of. I've been told that you've been bold with Harry, Mark, and John. Monday and Tuesday, Wednesday through Thursday, with Harry, Mark, and John. Satellite's gone up to the skies. Things like that drive me out of my mind. I watched it for a things on TV.
Lou Reed, for those who are listening on the podcast, Satellite of Love. Well done, Matt. Folks, it's Casual Friday, and on some Casual Fridays, we actually get this casual that we play this song.
Are you ready for some pee-pee? A bit of hullabaloo should do ya. How about some hullabaloo?
There you go. Who did that song?
Hot Cologne.
Hot Cologne. I don't know who that is, but Hot Cologne doing the Digby song. Heather Parton, Digby, welcome back to the program.
Thanks for having me. I'm so thrilled to have my own song.
Yeah, right? That's a pretty good one. And it's like a...
Yeah.
Well, you know, I can't quite place that song, but I know... It sort of reminds me a little bit of Squeeze.
It does, and I love Squeeze, one of my favorite bands of the 70s. So it's very cool.
Wait,
and,
Squeeze is 70s
yeah, I mean,
or 80s?
I love it.
80s. Squeeze was 80s.
They were around in the late 70s, too.
All right. Well,
I was there, Sam. I know.
I've been put in my place. all right. So, Heather.
I'm embarrassed to admit. Yeah.
A lot of insanity this week. I mean, probably not that different from other weeks. But this, I want to talk about there is a report now that the Turks have told U.S. officials that they have audio and video recordings that prove that Jamal Khashoggi, this is a Washington Post columnist who is a U.S. resident. He had traveled to Turkey, was going to the consulate in Istanbul to get paperwork ostensibly for his marriage. And he went in, never came out. And apparently, U.S. intelligence services had word that Mohammed bin Salman had the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia had basically personally ordered this guy to be killed. And now the Turkish government is saying that they have audio and video. Apparently, they bug everywhere in Turkey. That proves that you can hear the guy being beaten, the guy being killed. And they have played this for or given it or made U.S. officials aware of this. I just want to remind people, we played this video yesterday, but I want to remind this people, this is what Donald Trump's response was. I think it was his second response to the Khashoggi killing. And this is what his response was in the White House.
So what good does that do us? There are other things we can do.
Well, do you think they should pay a price if it's
yeah, there'll be something that has to take place. First, I want to find out what happened. And we're looking. Again, this took place in Turkey. And to the best of our knowledge, Khashoggi is not a United States citizen. Is that right? Or
permanent
is that
resident.
Right? He's a permanent resident. Okay. We don't like it, John. We don't like
Pause
it.
Pause it for 1 second. I love how, Heather, that Trump says, to the best of our knowledge. He's not, what he's basically saying is like, I haven't quite read into this yet. I just, and then someone says he was a resident. Okay, right. Okay. Well, I guess our knowledge is a little more updated than I thought.
Get Steve Ducey on the horn here. I need to find out if he was actually an American citizen or
right,
not.
Right, exactly.
Like, would that make his killing less bad if he wasn't a citizen?
No, if he was a citizen.
Trump.
I mean, yeah.
Well, to Trump, obviously, from their perspective, that is part of their American first, you know, in that their obligations are less if he's just a resident. But continue.
And we don't like it even a little bit. But as to whether or not we should stop $110 billion from being spent in this country, knowing they have four or five alternatives, two very good alternatives, that would not be acceptable to me. Okay, but we're looking for the answer, and I think probably you'll have an answer sooner than people think.
Yeah, right. Okay, so, I mean, first off, it's not $110 billion. I think the deal is for something closer to like $30 billion, but that's irrelevant, right? This calculation, and it may be the case that the Saudis can go to China or to Russia to buy the military equipment they want. I don't know that it would be that easy for them to do that, but I suppose they could. But that calculation of our American foreign policy, I mean, here's the thing. Trump puts it in rather stark terms, but that calculation of American foreign policy seems to me to have dictated the relationship we've had with Saudi Arabia for decades.
Well, true. And plus the oil. You know, right. Let's not forget that. I mean, you know, remember, and it's one thing to keep in mind as we look at this story, I think, is, you know, remember, you know, Bandar Bush, the envoy from Saudi Arabia that was great friends, so close with the Bush family that he was called a member of the Bush family.
Yep.
Pictures of Bush going all the way, Obama, Clinton, you know, going all the way back, holding hands with, literally holding hands with you know, members of the Saudi royal family. Nothing new about that, and it's always been concerning, particularly now that we've decided to really arm up the Saudi Arabian military so that they can fight our proxy wars over there, which is even more repulsive than it has been in the past. Nonetheless, let's not, you know, try and pretend that this is business as usual, because it really isn't. This has escalated under Trump in a new direction that I don't think we've ever quite seen before, and it has to do with two things. Number one, the president being the personal arms dealer of the world, you know, this is what he considers himself to be. That's a little unusual, putting it right out there in the front, going, hey, man, you know, we got money involved here, dudes, we got to do it. To say this up front, no regard for human rights at all, is a change. I mean, there's always been, you know, tension is probably not the right word to use. There's always been tremendous hypocrisy there, but there was at least some, you know, sense that the United States was going to at least rhetorically stand up for human rights. The second thing, of course, is the fact that Trump himself apparently has a lot of personal financial dealings with Saudi Arabia. He's on record saying that he gets $40, $50 million a year from Saudi. We know that Jared Kushner, who's great friends with the new more autocratic young prince who's taken over the country, Mohammed bin Salman, MBS they call him. And he and Jared are big buds, and they, you know, have all-nighters together and do a lot of back-channel discussion, evidently. That's something that's a little bit different. And Jared Kushner and his family have tremendous financial exposure. Apparently they've been begging for money throughout that area for a long time. And then finally, you have the fact that Trump is also on record and has been since the time he started campaigning as saying that he doesn't care if foreign leaders kill journalists. I mean, they asked him about Vladimir Putin. He went, hey, you know, there's a lot of killing going on
right.
in this world. We've killed people, too, so let's not get too, you know, fine and fancy here. That's just the way, and he said, that's just the way it is. You can't blame anybody, really, for looking at the comments that President Trump makes about the press over and over and over again, and authoritarians all over the world are mimicking him now, and believing that he's not going to really go to the mat if they decide to take out a journalist who is critical of their regime. So, you know, we do have some new elements to this Saudi-U.S. relationship that have taken this to an even more corrupt level than it's ever been before.
How messed up is it that the enabling of a civil war that's killing hundreds, if not thousands, of civilians, right? The most recent high profile was killing 40 school children on a bus. I mean, you know, like, I understand why the press gets agitated, and I think, like, anything that in any way inhibits the relationship that we have with Saudi Arabia, I think, is a positive thing. But we live in a weird, I mean, it's just sad to me that the Khashoggi killing, and I understand why, right? It's a lot more intriguing than just sort of the same old, oh, we're supporting the killing of people in Yemen. I mean, who, you know, that's old hat. But it is sort of stunning that we can't get as exercised about that as a society as we can about one columnist.
Well, particularly, and let's, you know, I mean, I do think that the concerns about, you know, the safety of journalists worldwide, particularly considering that there seems to be an escalation of, I mean, I think it was Bulgaria?
Right.
Just this past week had another horrific, you know, rape and killing of a of a journalist there who had been doing some kind of investigative work on
anti-corruption,
corruption, and
right.
anti-corruption. I mean, this stuff is happening a lot, let's just put it that way, in these sort of authoritarian regimes. It's very disturbing. And, of course, you know, you hear the echoes of it here and places like Brazil and other places where you feel this kind of authoritarian stuff rising. Now, but what you say, of course, is true, and this the war in Yemen, I mean, this has been sort of in the background here for years. This is not something that is unique to the Trump administration, although from everything I've been reading recently, they have escalated it, or at least sort of enabled it in a much more obvious way than the Obama administration, which had evidently been trying to ratchet it back in some respects. But it doesn't matter, because nonetheless, the fact is that we've been supplying money and arms to other countries to fight this war that nobody really understands. It's another one of those, right? I mean,
right.
How many do we have to have? And you'd think, you know, I think that what happens is that people sort of get the idea that these proxy wars that happen all over the world, that somehow or another, I don't know, is there some theory that maybe they're letting off steam in small places so that a bigger explosion doesn't happen? I mean, I don't even know. But it seems like I've been reading about this my whole life, and I'm old. So, you know, this has been going on for a long, long time. And, you know, maybe one of the, things about Trump, which is really kind of perverse, is that his America First philosophy, to the extent that it's a philosophy, it really isn't, it's a slogan. But somehow or another, it's mixing all that up, right? I mean, it's at least kind of stirring it up in a way that people who don't normally take a position on those sorts of things are looking at it in a different way, because coming from Trump, it means something different than it has in the past. So maybe that will be a salutary effect of this train wreck of an administration. I don't know.
Well, I mean, talking about that and just pivoting from that, because, you know, the Kavanaugh confirmation, and, you know, it was the short circuiting of the investigation, the withholding of documents, juxtaposing this to the Republicans not giving Merrick Garland a hearing, the implications of Kavanaugh on the court. I mean, you know, where Neil Gorsuch apparently was like, I don't know about this permanent detention thing for immigrants years after they've been, you know, gotten some type of, parking ticket or something. You know, when Neil Gorsuch is the voice of reason now on the court. I mean, this whole Kavanaugh thing seems to me, and people are writing about it, like, to the extent that, and you wrote a piece that there's no daylight between Trump and the Republicans anymore. I just the idea that has to be written, like, that it isn't that your editor wouldn't say, like, come on, Heather, everybody knows that, right? Like, there still is this sort of quality. There was nothing about the Kavanaugh hearing, maybe a little bit, but just more almost like literary. Right. If I was drawing, like, you know, some type of, like, it was a literary device. Oh, I know the thing that can hold this guy up. It can be that he has these accusations of sexual assault, which would be a good tie in and, like, a nice reflection of the president who nominated him. But that's just a literary device. But I mean, putting that aside, every other dynamic about it was purely Republican. And somehow we still have the situation where, like, the Republicans are not, the idea that Jeff Flake can get up there and say, like, we should have someone challenge the president because what's going on here is not about the Republican Party, and, you know, but it is, but it totally is. Donald Trump is not the cause of the Republican Party. Donald Trump is just simply an outward manifestation. He's just a lesion that is coming from a bigger disease, and the lesion hurts and it's disgusting and it's problematic, but that's not the root of the problem. I mean, we saw it. Kavanaugh, the whole Kavanaugh fiasco, it seems to me, to exemplify this. And my sense is like there isn't, there hasn't been this, our society has not absorbed that.
Well, there's obviously a deep, deep yearning for this not to be true, right? I mean, and here's a perfect way of sort of, you know, bookending it. The John McCain funeral, in which everybody went, oh, you know, look, it's the establishment and they care and, you know, this is what it used to be like. And, oh, look, George Bush, he handed Michelle Obama a cough drop and they're just, you know, they're look how they get along. It's a beautiful thing. And this is the way it used to be. Fast forward, you know, what, 2-3 weeks, whatever it was, and you've got the Kavanaugh hearing. And all hell breaks loose. We've got, you know, protesters in the hallways and everybody's all upset. And, you know, what we find out is that Brett Kavanaugh, who is, by the way, I mean, he's going to make, we're going to be yearning for Antonin Scalia, because Scalia, at least, was not a pure, unadulterated political operative sitting on the Supreme Court. He was a right winger. He was, you know,
he was a slightly adulterated operative.
But no, but he didn't come up that way.
That wasn't his pedigree. That's right. That wasn't his pedigree.
Right. And he had developed a philosophy, which, you know, you and I obviously find odious and somewhat stupid, but it was just originalism. You know, we got to do a mind meld with, you know, Thomas Jefferson in order to understand what the law should be today. All of that. But it did exist on a certain kind of intellectual plane. And Kavanaugh does not come from that. And in fact, he isn't that. He's just solely on that court to advance the right wing agenda in whatever way it's necessary to do it. I don't think you're going to find intellectual consistency in any way from this guy. Now, that man was basically put on the court not just by Donald Trump, who knows nothing about, you know, Supreme Court justices or conservative jurisprudence, nothing. If there was a reason that he put him on there, it was probably because he figured he got a good loyal vote for him that he can pardon himself, right? That's about the extent of his reasoning behind it, and that he could score a big win. The person who put him on that court was George W. Bush, and
right,
the way he did it was by lobbying Susan Collins over and over again. She's a big friend of the family, and they love Brett, and he's a good guy, and he's one of them. So, you know, that's where that came from. That merging, you could see it right there in that particular you know, event, and it was a huge political event, you know, all the Sturm und Drang and emotion that went into that. But essentially, that was the Republican establishment putting a right-wing political operative hitman on the court. And that has nothing to – that's not Trump. That's them. And they pulled out all the stops to get that done. And at the end of the day, when Susan Collins gave her speech – in which she gaslighted the whole country and was willing to stand up in front of everybody and make this big, big, you know, sort of grand statement telling us that Brett Kavanaugh is not the man we saw with our own eyes just days before, acting like a, you know, a petulant schoolyard bully in front of the U.S. Senate. No, that never happened. He's really a wonderful person. He's a great guy, and he's going to be fine. And, you know, all you people, the protesters and the special interests and all this, she said she could have easily been Donald Trump. I mean, it's her own particular spin on it, but everything she said in that speech was Trumpian. And so, you know, we see the full absorption of whatever was tattered remains there were of the Republican establishment came together, and there they are. And I don't see anybody, I don't see it going back in any way. Do you?
No.
I mean, when are these, what, how are these people gonna retract any of this stuff? I mean, this is them. This is who they are.
Well, I think they're going to be able to retract it if there's not a broader understanding of that's what happened. I mean, so point in case, or case in point, I should say, Chuck Schumer, once again, just yesterday, basically crafts a deal. I'm hesitant to say deal because usually there's like there's two aspects of a deal, right? The give and the get. Chuck Schumer crafts a deal yesterday to essentially fast track 15 Trump judges, three or four on the Court of Appeals, I think it was, These are all lifetime positions on federal on the federal judiciary. Ostensibly, it was so that Democratic senators can go home and campaign and protect themselves. It is the case, my understanding, that it would have taken 30 senators to essentially slow down this process dramatically, and that would have meant keeping every Republican senator in Washington, right? Like, each senator could have been responsible for talking for an hour, which would have allowed for 30 hours of debate on each of the confirmees or the nominees, and all the Republicans would have to be there to vote. And that's, if Chuck Schumer's not willing to do this or can't convince his caucus to do this, why should anyone else take the judiciary seriously? Like, 30 judges with lifetime appointments have been brought to the Supreme, to the federal courts within the last 60 days. And Heidi Heitkamp, and this is also a problem with the media, too. I mean, even the left-wing media. Heidi Heitkamp could very well lose her race in North Dakota now because of a ruling by the Eighth Circuit Court on a voter ID case, right? It went up to the Supreme Court 4-4. It bounces back down, and it's the ruling of this Eighth Circuit Court that's going to hold. There are 11 justices on there. 10 of them are appointed by Republican presidents, including 3 by Trump. There's one justice who was appointed by Obama. That justice was the one who dissented in the 2-1 decision that is basically going to disenfranchise thousands of Native Americans because they have a P.O. box on their ID instead of a street address. There's a disconnect here. There's a disconnect. There's a reason why you can't get the people on the left to care about the judges, because Chuck Schumer, like, there's never going to be a mass protest against Chuck Schumer to not, usher in 15, 30 judges at the wave of a hand. But that it has to come from the leadership. I mean, this just seems to be just shocking.
Yeah, and I mean, look, there were mass protests just a week ago of people in the Capitol building, protesting
Kavanaugh,
vociferously against Kavanaugh.
Right.
And that should have shown that, you've got a base that's got your back here, Democrats. They're here. They're trying to reinforce what the Democrats on the Judiciary Committee were attempting to do. Which was at least put up a fight, at least show that there was, that they were working it to the extent possible. I don't understand this. I suspect that what's happened is that Mitch McConnell and Trump too, all of them have decided, they've launched this, mob mentality thing, right, where it's the angry mob based upon a bunch of rape survivors coming and giving testimony in the hallways in the Senate 2 weeks ago, which apparently was just really frightening to all these Republican senators. They're just terrified by that angry mob of women, rape survivors. That this is the new thing. They say, they're out of control. They're getting violent. They're doing this, in a tremendous case of projection, the pot calling the kettle black. But nonetheless, I don't think it has to do with they're not trying to fool their own people into being afraid, right? I think that is a mistake, an interpretation of what this is about. What this is about is trying to Hector Chuck Schumer and the rest of the Democratic leadership into doing things like what they just did in the hopes that what they will do is suppress their own base. They're trying to get the Democrats to behave in craven fashion and get scared so that they can somehow or another disappoint the base of the Democratic Party and maybe, let the air out of some of this enthusiasm. I don't think it will work. I think that enthusiasm has a life of its own, and it's not based on anything Chuck Schumer does. But that's my theory about what they're trying to do, because I don't think there are no right-wingers at Trump rallies who are actually afraid of the left's angry mob, right? That just goes against that dissonant on how they think of the left snowflakes who, you know, are too sensitive to breathe. So that's not really what they're doing. They're trying to get Schumer to do things like this. And by the way, that stuff really works with the Democratic leadership, is, you know, saying, oh, you better not get out of hand, boys. You know, you're going to ruin everything for yourself. And they kind of go, oh, okay, you know, don't make trouble.
I think that's absolutely right. I mean, if you remember in the run up to the vote for Kavanaugh, the whole thing looked like this is really bad for Democrats. Mm-hmm. And then it turns out that no, actually the polling that came in afterwards shows that it's not bad for Democrats. You know, like there was. When we get between, you know, September 1st and really October 1st, what happens is all of those undecided, all the people who have not been paying attention, they basically come home. And so, you know, those people who are naturally going to be Republican voters, they come home and shore up maybe some places. That's like, you know, I think what happened with Ted Cruz, you know, Texas mm-hmm. is a Republican state. You know, Beto looked really good and we got all excited about him. He still, you know, has a chance, but because we don't know who's really going to turn up. But those Republicans are in a very red state, and Texas is still a red state. And they're going to come back out for the Republican. And I think on some level, like, I don't understand how the Democrats don't have this level of savvy. And people can say, well, it's not a question of savvy. You know, they really want these people on the circuit court. I that to me just seems far-fetched. I don't think that there's...
I agree with you. I don't think that's true. I mean, it's very easy to develop that level of cynicism. And I'm sure it's true for some people, right? Somebody struck a deal somewhere.
Right.
Somehow their, you know, corporate interests, you know, will supersede whatever. But this is an existential threat to Democrats, this court packing that is going on during the Trump administration. It really is. I mean, you know, this is a Supreme Court that had already overturned the Voting Rights Act. And the case that you just mentioned, let's face it, if that had been gone to the full court with Kavanaugh on it, the same thing would have happened, right? I mean, it's not like he's going to suddenly have a you know, a surge of conscience and say, oh, I don't want to disenfranchise a bunch of Native Americans. I mean, we know where he's going. So, you know, the situation with voting and immigration in this country across the board on a federal level, which, of course, both of those things end up being voting, in the end, always ends up being a federal issue, and immigration is a federal issue. This is an existential threat to the Democratic Party. There's a reason why they want all these people on the court, and that's because they want this ongoing sort of degradation of democracy that we're seeing with a minority rule being the rule more often. People, you know, we've had two presidential elections in the last 16 years that were decided in the Electoral College instead of the popular vote. That only happened once before in our history, back in the 1800s. So, you know, this is becoming the new normal. They are, you know, I hate to use a Trumpian word, but they're rigging the system. And the fact that Democrats are not, you know, going to the mat on that particular issue is an act of political suicide.
Yeah.
I mean, that just does not make sense to me. I mean, this is one of those things where, and it's one of the reasons why I thought the Kavanaugh fight was, you know, I'm going, okay, you know, at least start putting the pressure on going the other direction here. You've got to stop. And suddenly people are talking about, you know, adding seats to the court and doing various other things. They have to. This isn't a matter of just, well, you know, we don't want to push too hard here, or that would be uncivil or whatever. I mean, they have to do it. Otherwise, look at what they're doing. I mean, it's happening before our eyes. And they are basically setting up a system that will allow them to seize federal power, and in many cases in the states as well, with minority rule for as far as the eye can see, based upon these rulings that are making it possible for a minority Republican Party to nonetheless win elections. I mean, that's, you know, this is something out of some banana republic. You know, this is something that is happening, and the Democrats seem to be sort of blinking and going, gee, what do we do? And it's crazy.
It's crazy. I never thought. I mean, I was not as skeptical as Harry of Harry Reid, I think, as some. But I never thought that I would have this much of a sense of longing for a guy like Harry Reid, frankly. I mean, I think Chuck Schumer has made some major, major missteps. I mean, this is one of them. I think also, you know, I think we've talked about this in the past a couple of years ago with that going into December and that deal he made where he thought he was going to get DACA. You know, it's funny because I think it was Weigel. I can't remember, but we had a conversation. I'm pretty sure it was on this show with a reporter who said, you know, by and large, the senatorial caucus is happy with Schumer. And that to me is disturbing, too. I mean, I don't know how easy it is to get rid of a Senate leader, but gosh, he just doesn't seem to quite get it.
Well, think about this too. I mean, Harry Reid, for all of his faults, and he had plenty. I mean, you know, I don't worship the guy, but he came from a state where he had to actually fight for every election too.
Right.
You know, I mean, Nevada is a swing state at best, often a red state, and he had to fight for every election, and yet he had this, you know, sort of pugilistic style about him. And you've got Schumer there. He's from New York, for crying out loud. I mean, he is the one, you know, he's not going to lose his seat, right? I mean, he's as safe as he can be. I think that maybe in Schumer's case, this may be the one situation, you know, you and I were just saying, well, you know, it isn't really that they're, you know, thoroughly corrupt. It's that, you know, they're just kind of dumb. In Schumer's case, you know, he really has some allegiance to certain industries, Wall Street in particular, that another Democrat would not have.
Right.
This is a very, you know, symbiotic relationship between the senator, this particular senator from New York, and the, you know, big financial industry concerns. And I think that's something Democrats should think about when they're dealing with their leadership. You know, it's nice to have them in a safe state, safe, you know, district or state. I agree with that. That gives them a lot more leeway. But it
not if it doesn't give them
state,
leeway,
right?
Right? I mean, yeah, I agree. I agree totally. Well, hopefully we'll start to see some. I don't know where how that happens. I mean, I don't know how how that happens. But Chuck Schumer is increasingly problematic, and I think it's.
Does
important.
Anybody know how he? Because I had always thought, and this is a question I really should do some research on. I thought that Dick Durbin was the guy who was next in line to be after Reid, right? I mean, he had always sort of been his second in command, and maybe he doesn't have, I don't know, some kind of leadership quality, but I had always thought he was the guy. He's more, you know, traditionally liberal than Schumer is.
Yep.
And then somehow or another Schumer got the job, and I've always wondered what the dynamic was there. I don't really know. And then he talked about Patty Murray, too, who's also, you know, a powerful person in leadership. I don't really know exactly why Schumer ended up in that spot. It wasn't a given for years and years, right? He was not sort of this, you know, the heir apparent. It's an interesting question. I'm sure there's an answer to it. I just don't happen to know it.
Nor do I, but, it's a shame it went that way. And I don't know, maybe we'll see an opportunity, soon. Heather, as always, a real pleasure. Thanks so much for your time this week.
Thanks for having me, Sam. Have a good weekend, everybody.
You too. Bye-bye. All right, folks. Going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll be talking to Matthew Film Guy, ostensibly here to give us a film suggestion, but you never know with Matthew Film Guy what you're going to get, right? Life is like a box of chocolates.
You never know which depressing Swedish film you're going to get.
There you go. We'll be right back after this.
I never ending.
We are back. Sam Cedar, Majority Report. Ladies and gentlemen, it is Friday in almost everywhere that you're listening, although I guess conceivably if you are listening in Australia, it is Saturday. But nevertheless, when it is Friday here in the eastern part of the United States, or Saturday in Australia, what we do is we occasionally have a guest on who will give us a film recommendation for the upcoming weekend. And this week, that guy is the guy depicted in this song. Matthew, film guy.
Great song.
What do you have for us, Matthew, that could possibly be any more unbelievable than what we saw yesterday with Kanye in the White House? Is there anything, I mean, is fiction, well, maybe I'm getting ahead of myself, Matthew. How are you? How's that?
I'm great, Sam. How are you? I'm just sitting here in my epistemological bubble watching depressing Swedish films.
There you go. Anyone in particular, or just do you just have like a montage, like a clip reel of depressing Swedish films?
It's just constant Swedish films, only Swedish. Actually, have I ever recommended a Swedish film to you people? I don't think so.
I think you have.
I would be very surprised.
That is a slanderous.
I think it's a family that has multiple lines of incest, but really it's about late stage capitalism, but also incest in a way that you might find unsettling because we don't know. Yeah, it's my impression of a film guy.
Michael, did I tell you what this week's film is already? Jeez.
It's incest, but it's really, aren't we all committing incest in a certain way, if you think about it, the way we relate to our planet's finite resources. Anyway, it also reminds me of Castavetti's sap.
Yeah, take note, everybody. If you're going to mock me, that is the way to do it.
There you go. Now, Matthew, but before we get to any more mocking for the time being.
Yeah.
And
why not?
What's that?
Yeah, why not? Go ahead.
What's new with you? What are you doing these days? Any new interesting projects? Did you work on this Ted Alexandro? Is it a concert movie?
Yeah, his hour special that finally came out. Everybody can go to atcspecials.com. He put it out through the artist-owned comedians collective company called All Things Comedy. You know, they're sort of like, do you remember United Artists? What they were for Hollywood.
Yeah.
This is what they sort of started, comedian run, artist owned. And so his new special, Senior Class of Earth, is out. People have heard me talk about it. But really, you know, you should talk to Ted yourself directly and have him tell you how great it is. Because all I can tell you is that I had a great time working on it. Mary and I produced it and directed it, and I edited it. It's really, I'm very proud of it. It's funny and it's political, but it's also just, you know, a little bit of lightheartedness about the shitstorm that is our current lives.
We should have Ted on. We'll see if we can we'll put that into the machine that we have here and see if we can.
Well, that's very kind of you, Sam. I think that's a great idea.
But wait, tell me a little bit more about this collective, or maybe I should wait and ask him about it.
I don't know that much about it. I know that Bill Burr and Al Madrigal started it, and they basically are kind of a, you know, this is Ted's is actually their first special. So their first, they started out doing albums and a lot of podcasts. They have a big variety of comedian podcasts, which is a thing.
All right.
And this is their first foray.
I don't want to promote any competitors. So
that's right.
Forget that. No, that sounds interesting to me. I was not aware of it. I was not aware of that that collective. I like to hear stuff like that. I think that's good.
Yeah, me too. Me too. Even if you're not a huge fan of all the comedians involved, I think the premise is a great one.
Ooh,
and it's worth supporting.
That's a little red flaggy.
Well, look, they run the gamut, you know. Bill Burr and Al Madrigal are two high quality comedians, but there's some lesser known names that necessarily aren't my cup of tea. But they definitely showed their bona fides in terms of
thing.
Where they know talent when they see it by buying Ted's special and producing it and putting it out themselves. So everyone go to atcspecials.com and check it out right after you check out my eBay.
Yeah. All right. Well, Matthew, so what else have you been doing? How long ago did you edit and produce and direct that thing?
There's no need to mention that. But it's a process getting it to the right audience. So we shot it last year, and we've been working on it ever since.
All right, I'm just curious what the turnaround time for your other project is.
I've just been watching Swedish movies the whole time since then. So
I'm just curious as to what your turnaround time for your other projects are.
It's an incestual relationship between a brother and a sister, but actually it turns out to be a father and a daughter, which is sort of the twist. But really it's an indictment of patriarchy and the
sense
that
I've run
that
out
we
of father-daughter incest capitalism films, but I'm going to find more.
Comfortable in our own skin, but should we? It's about 5 hours long. Everybody should check it out.
Are you teaching at your learning annex thing too?
Yes, we're gearing up for the new fall section. I wouldn't call it a semester, but yeah, we're gearing up for that. I've just been programming that. I've got a lot of good stuff lined up for that. Films of deep soul-searing truth to spring on unsuspecting senior citizens of the Jewish persuasion. Yes.
Now, have you ever thought about branching out to like senior citizens of like non-Jewish senior citizens, or just you're just going to
about just Polish or Chinese?
Fa. All right. Fair enough. There you have it.
But no, I just got back from a short vacation. The first one I was able to take in a long time down to my mother's in Boca. And I was able to actually catch up on a lot of, you know, as a film guy, you amass a large list of films that you're supposed to be seeing at all times. And I actually was recently able to get through a sizable chunk of some of those.
It's funny that John Benjamin in his book, Failure is an Option, which incidentally was coincidentally the name of a script I had written for AMC about 5 years ago. Just total coincidence. John had absolutely
must be total coincidence.
But John retold a story. I was in that book. I finally listened to that book of his. And I was part of like half of those stories. And
I learned. That's amazing.
Not credit.
Are you allowed to say which ones?
I don't care. I don't. What is he going to do? Sue me about my own stories?
yes, I guess not. But, I was in it too, but I'm not necessarily proud of my contribution.
That's right. He doesn't. He didn't mention you, did he?
No, and he didn't mention you either.
Well, he did mention me, but not in the context of the other stories, like the story about the script. Where we got commissioned to write a script about a community like the one you went to in Boca.
Yes.
And we went down there. We had an entree into the community from his brother-in-law's dad. And we ended up paying the brother-in-law's dad to write the script for us. He was a
That is, I think, a genius level Andy Kaufman style idea.
75-year-old Jewish man from a retirement community who will love
lots of Viagra jokes, lots of fart jokes.
Yes, he wrote the script, and we handed it in to Conan O'Brien's company. And the note session was pretty funny when they were basically saying like, we feel like you guys are like maybe trying a little too hard to be funny in this one. We're like, what do you mean? And
I love that story. That was one of the highlights of John Benjamin's
book. It was so obnoxious.
I highly recommend it. Audiobook.
We actually paid like a significant portion of our fee. And then when we told them that we did it, and John and I were just laughing. We thought it was so funny. And they were just like, why did you do that?
Because it's funny.
We don't.
No one has a sense of humor around here.
We don't get it. We hired you to write a script, and you thought it would be funny to give us someone else's script that was bad?
Yes. I'm actually genuine. Like, I get them.
Oh, no, I get them.
No, I'm saying even from them. I get them being pissed, but I genuinely don't understand how that is objectively funny.
I think it probably added to our cachet in some fashion. Like, but
these guys are thinking outside of all the boxes.
Oh, yes, totally. Like, they're in a completely, whose box is this? But
they're so far outside the box, they're in a different box.
Yeah, it was a totally different box. I mean, when we found him, he was directing, like, I can't remember what it was. It was some, you know.
It was like community theater or something. It was
community
like Jewish
theory.
Interpretations of community theater
exactly.
projects.
Exactly. It would have been like, you know, the Schmata Man instead of the Music Man or something. Some
right,
weird
right,
stuff
yeah.
like that. But Matthew, let's.
My Fair Yenta.
Yeah, exactly. Let's leave that diversion. Are you working on any interesting projects that we might be interested in? No?
No. I actually have a couple projects that are brewing, but I can't really talk about them right now. You know, as I'm always working on my home movie film, and I actually, while I was in Boca, wound up running into four more reels of untransferred Super 8 film that my father took as part of his massive surveillance project.
How many hours of footage are you combing through to make a how long of a movie? Because this is something you have been doing for...
I've been working on this for at least 15 plus years because every time I get off of another project, I put a little time into it.
I got news for you, buddy.
Massive.
I got news for you. You were working on this pretty sure when we met, which would have been in 2001.
All right. So now almost 20 years. Sure. Right. That sounds right. I've been spending money on transferring it little by little, but you know, I always felt like I wasn't mature enough to make it at the beginning. You know, I didn't want it to be some sort of like,
I would agree with
you
that.
Know, there's a genre of documentaries of like, this is how my parents fucked me up. Like, I didn't necessarily want to make another entry in that genre. I wanted something a little more broad or at least a little more nuanced. But I don't know, maybe I'm coming back to that theme as time goes on. But anyway, I found two more.
How did your parents?
What's that?
How did your parents? I mean, just give me the elevator pitch. On how your parents screwed you up and how it's going to be reflected in this documentary.
Let's see, elevator pitch. A combination of benign neglect and over controlling.
Okay, and that, I mean, it sounds to me that you
maybe
should
the a healthy
that
dose
be right
of narcissism.
In the
I'm not sure. This is, you know, it's developing. A lot of therapy going into the making of this movie.
I see. So this is a big budget film in a way.
Yes, it is. The biggest. The cast of thousands of neuroses.
And so what's new on the eBay front? Anything new on that front? I mean, what are you...
You know, people can go check it out. Go to my Twitter at Langdon Boom, and you can see that I have some stuff listed. You know, I'm getting rid of some stuff. I've lost a lot of weight in the past 6 months, so I'm kind of like moving through some fat clothes.
Nice. Is that right?
What have you been doing?
Like Matthew Film Guy.
How have you been doing that?
Literally just diet. You know, I got like a scary cholesterol level in January, and the doctor's like, you've got to come in right away and like massively change your diet. So I went on like a really serious, just low fat, low cholesterol, low animal product diet, and wound up losing a lot of weight. Like literally no exercise even added or changed.
I'm sure.
But
I'm
I do
sure.
have a fitness tracker.
I'm
so
sure.
anyway,
I thought
so
you
some
you
clothes
do
going
karate.
Out.
What, so huh? wait, so give me a sense. Like, what is that diet? I'm curious what that looks like. A low animal protein?
You know, I ate no dairy. I had, like, you know, steamed chicken and tofu for dinner, like, half the nights of the week, you know, from the Chinese place. Just anything grilled at home with, like, a teaspoon of olive oil. It was, like, super serious. I've since let up on that since my cholesterol got back under control, but... you know, it was massive.
And so
it was a massive
how much weight did you lose? We're only in October. You're 10 months. How much weight?
Well, I had already, by my second blood test, which was in July, I had already lost like 25 pounds. And I think
wow.
I've lost another like 10 since then.
You know, so according to Jordan Peterson, you could have lost more weight if you'd had an all-steak diet.
Yes, I know it's not healthy. I know it's not a healthy amount, but I lost 35 pounds in 8 months.
It's as you call it, diet or whatever, but if you drink it to New York strip steaks and
it was like 57 pounds in
you'll
6 months.
You'll lose 57
yeah,
pounds.
He lost 60 pounds. He lapped me for sure. So yeah. Go on
by
Jordan Peterson's diet
steak?
If you really
by
want to
eating,
be massive. And also your psoriasis and your snoring and all that. Actually, I do think my snoring was relieved by weight loss. But,
oh, yeah,
you know,
definitely. That will definitely do it. But wait a second. He lost 60 pounds by eating only steak?
Well, he ate only meat and greens, but in the last 6 months he's done with the greens and he only eats meat now.
Oh, so that's the Atkins diet.
It's not even Atkins because Atkins the
it's like paleo.
It's not even paleo. I don't think
paleo
there's
you can
no.
eat
no,
vegetables.
No, those especially paleo they actually encourage you to
no,
eat vegetables.
No, paleo does Atkins no. Not
Atkins, no vegetables, but not literally just meat. I don't think there's any diet where you literally.
They would tell
just,
you that you could no, also eat dairy.
Yeah, he wouldn't. No dairy, no eggs. He's just meat.
Meat
no,
and
no
meat.
No eggs.
Extra raw, no, please. Extra raw, please. And so, all sorts of psychic ailments I've had have gone away, too.
You know what? That
I've stopped using. I've stopped using utensils. I just
something.
Eat with my fists and my teeth.
There's going to be an epidemic
I did
of
the
scurvy.
Atkins diet. I did the Atkins,
you did the Atkins diet
in like 1998 or something.
Wow.
You know, and
when it was cool.
When it was cool. When it first came
what
out.
What did you eat?
But I ate eggs and like sausage and cheese. And
I want
just
eggs
all
and bacon.
Fat and protein.
Did you
lose
weight?
Lots of chicken wings, Sam, if I recall.
And
I think I saw you eat a
you
lot
lost
of chicken
weight,
wings.
Right?
How'd you feel?
Oh, yeah. I felt like I was on steroids.
Yes.
You mean your nuts shrank? What happened?
I got very aggressive.
Very aggro.
Very aggro. Felt like I was like I had a tremendous amount of energy. My heart rate went up probably like by 15 to 20%. Like,
sounds healthy.
Just like I could just feel my heart. Like at any given time, I could feel my heart pumping. I'm just like, this is amazing.
That's awesome.
I can't believe I'm. You know.
Why are we not all on the Atkins diet?
At that
you
time,
were high yeah. on factory sounds farm good. Animal fear.
And, yes. and I'll tell you something. You, I, so you become yes. an evangel. You become evangelical about it. Like I'm just
right.
going around. I remember like saying like, I don't know why you're not on this diet, man. I mean, this I've never felt so great in my life. And it's,
eat this raw meat. I mean, eat this meat.
And I remember being at Sundance, staying with. It was some like a festival, and for breakfast, just like having like six eggs and like a pound of cheese and like an entire salami and just sitting there going like, this is the most amazing thing I've ever felt. This great in my life. And then at one point you start to feel like I'm going to die. Like I just like my organs feel like they have like gone through 10 years in the span of like 4 weeks and you stop. But I had never felt. And my body reacted very well to it. I mean, at least, you know, like I felt great. But then afterwards, you get scary.
A medical report issued by the New York Medical Examiner's Office a year after his death showed that Atkins had a history of heart attack, congestive heart mm-hmm. failure, and hypertension. Mm-hmm. His widow refused to allow an autopsy.
Right. There you go. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
But man, did he look good?
Oh,
did
he
look
good?
A great looking
felt
horse.
Good. He was working hard.
It's like the most American thing I've ever heard.
It honestly was like it's like taking steroids. I was just like, I'm gonna win. I'm gonna eat breakfast and then I'm gonna go out and I'm gonna win today.
I'm gonna eat breakfast and then I'm gonna make a situationist movie that's gonna fucking destroy your death.
I like that. It's, you apply
she
that.
Just,
that mentality.
Who's the caboose is going to be number one?
You apply that mentality.
I'm going to do the most offbeat eccentric comedy, which is a meta critique of Hollywood that nobody's ever fucking seen before. Dogma 95, you can eat my dust.
Isn't that basically Joe Rogan's approach?
Joe Rogan's, yeah. Well, again, yes, but the paleo is definitely. I did paleo briefly, and you're supposed to eat way more greens and veggies.
Oh, totally.
So it's not as insane.
You don't
as
stay away
Atkins.
From carbohydrates. It's just
you
stay
away
you
stay from
anything
grains
processed,
and processed
anything
foods.
Processed.
So you are not eating like.
And there's specific oils too, right? You're not supposed to have like olive oil. You're not supposed to cook
okay
with olive oil. No. You got to cook with like.
They're okay with coconut oil. They're really into they're
coconut.
Really into coconut oil.
Medium chain triglycerides.
Right.
Right.
So it's different.
I don't know why anyone would think that people were healthier back when they died at like age 30.
Right.
I don't know. Read, I don't know, Chris Ryan.
He says Chris Ryan.
That research is apparent, that's all bunk. In fact, that you should be into this. That the more cooperative indigenous societies had actually higher life expectancy than people write about and claim. And part of the Hobbesian argument against those societies and undermining some of their values is the idea that they lived shorter and more brutal lives. That isn't necessarily true, according to anthropological research.
What does that mean? Isn't necessarily true.
I mean, I take everything in both pro and con, like, I take all of this with some grain of salt. I'm just saying the idea that
salt's
indigenous
not good
for
you.
Societies.
You take paleo with, is there a specific type of salt?
It's deflated by, like, child mortality, right?
It's, yeah. But when you live, what people who yes, but when right. they actually lived, they didn't necessarily die at 30, and they actually had pretty high and healthy life expectancy. But that's
right.
not,
so if you
well,
made
that's
it
not
past,
about the
if
diet,
you made it,
though.
Made it past
that's
the
about
age
like,
of 60, you're going or 50.
Yeah, but then – and then the argument – right, right, yes.
Well, regardless, if we want to solve climate change, people are not going to be able to be paleo
Hobbs
for long.
Hobbs is wrong. I don't know about that if you buy locally sourced stuff, but whatever.
Well, yeah, but there's not enough.
That's debatable.
There's not enough. Like, there's not enough locally sourced stuff.
Right. That's
true.
Meat production's
no,
got
to
go down a lot.
People will need to reduce meat production, no doubt.
We'll make,
but,
we'll
I mean,
make it. We'll
but
make
it's also
it,
not about
chemically.
Yeah, just test tube.
Produced.
It.
Yeah, test
it's
tube.
Also
lab
not
meat.
About people's lifestyle.
Fully
decisions
support lab
either
meat.
Either way, though.
Well, no, of course.
But yes.
How could lab meat be any more disgusting than eating meat?
It's
I mean,
not.
I mean, that's what I'm saying. It's like it's. It's meat is it's gross no matter how you get it, and I'd say this is someone who likes. Who
I
likes
feel like
meat.
I
love
find
meat.
It gross.
It could
I
be more disgusting, but what if it's even? What if it's less disgusting?
Why? It, of course, it's less disgusting.
Than yeah, because you don't have to think about an animal like living in its own shit.
Imagine
or
if you could just like,
having to kill it.
Imagine if you could just grow chicken nuggets like a chia pet.
Well, the fry part is going to be the tough part.
You would love that, wouldn't you, Matt?
Like, how do you get it crispy and? So, Matthew, you still there?
Hello?
Do you have a critique of lab meat based off of your...
No, can I tell you how great this is? This is actually laying the groundwork for my suggestion today. Because I've actually
perfecto.
Personally been... What's that?
Perfecto. I had that sense.
Yeah. I've actually started... I flirted with vegetarianism in my youth, in college. I experimented.
I remember that.
But I always
and
felt...
vegetarianism actually lodged a complaint, I think. Go ahead.
Yes, but no witnesses. So, but I've actually started now coming back slowly to, you know, Mary is a not a vegetarian, but she doesn't eat red meat. And I've been starting to kind of think that way. But I saw a film recently that really kind of pushed me over the edge just in terms of, you know, I feel like my sense of who a person is expanding. This isn't like an environmental decision or even a political decision, although it has those ramifications. You know, you, at a certain point, I think you start to realize like sentient animals, even if they're so delicious, they're kind of like, they're, you know, they're people. They have agency and they kind of should not be eaten for food. And I've started to think, you know, I also have two dogs and actually maybe it's weird and it's that, like that Republican thing of like until it happens to you, you don't really, you know, you can't extend your empathy. But it has happened that just having four-legged animals around me makes me feel like every four-legged animal that I see, I'm now extending the same feeling of like sentience and kind of value inherently. So I'm cutting out eating four-legged animals. And this recently I saw this film that really just kind of tipped the scales completely.
Wasn't Frederick Wiseman's Meat, was it?
No, although that was definitely a chip in the foundation of, because that is a horrific
that thing
depiction
is
of...
brutal.
Brutal, really brutal, and it's in there. You know, it's one of the bricks that made up this kind of pedestal that finally I can see over, you know, the rest of my life what it actually means to eat four-legged animals.
Wait a second. Before we get into this, why four-legged? Yeah. Why are you drawing the line at four-legged? Like,
like I said, it's
chickens,
like
chickens. You're
because
a,
fish are assholes.
So wait a second. So you're
birds would kill us if they had the chance. No, yeah, okay. it's literally it's probably arbitrary,
it's
but it just feels like
true.
The first step.
Right.
That
right.
you know,
right.
like because I see my dogs and my dogs are four-legged. If I had a chicken as a pet, maybe I would feel this way too. And it is, like, I have to admit, it's a kind of selfishness of a convenience to not completely limit it to only vegetarian.
Well, I mean, the reason why we are, as a society anyways, and a lot of people are not, but the reason why as a society we're able to eat animals that are not human beings as opposed to eating human beings is because we feel some type of kinship, like some type of special kinship with human beings. And I think it's conceivable.
Right.
So it's not that strange to me that you would become that empathetic. Although the interesting flip side of that is some of the most I don't want to say aggressive meat eaters, but I know a lot of people who live on farms and or don't live on like what you would consider a farm per se, but like have, you know, a dozen or two dozen chickens. They raise a couple of pigs every, you know, they get them in the spring. And then actually around now, they slaughter them for the winter. They will hunt a deer, but they have all sorts of pets. They also have like three dogs and two cats that live in their house type of situation. So, I mean, it's interesting, you know, particularly like in the farm world, it's just sort of more like, I mean, not, this is not the case of every farm, but, in more rural areas, it's just like, oh yeah, you see that all the time. It's, one animal kills another and eats it.
I do not think I could deal with that. And that's why I don't eat meat, except for fish sometimes.
There you go.
Like, if I couldn't kill it myself, nah, I don't feel like I should eat it.
Fair enough.
And, like,
yeah,
I agree
with you. That makes total sense to me. And I don't know. I can't speak to sort of what the farm experience is. Like, I admit I'm completely removed from where the food I eat comes from. So there is that kind of, like, plausible deniability. And the more you understand it, I think, at least for me, the more I'm disgusted by it. And it is that, like you said, that sense of kinship, you know. And you know, it's funny. You guys, somebody, I think it was when Michael was hosting, you mentioned Ken Wilber and his kind of like levels of development. And I'm reading this book he wrote about the era of Trump in the post-truth world. And his whole thing is like this spiral dynamics where you're kind of growing from one stage to another, and each one is sort of more inclusive about who you feel is in your in-group. So at first it's just, you know, it's just you, then it's your family, then it's like your maybe your religion or your country, until eventually it's like everybody. And I feel like adding animals to that is kind of where I'm sort of going, you know, like
absolutely.
That makes a lot of sense. That makes a lot.
I think it's quite possible 50 years from now, 60 years from now, people will look back on eating animals in the same way that we look upon slavery.
What people will be looking back?
I kind of think so.
To the extent that there's any people.
I was going to say, we're donezo, baby.
Well, part of how we're going to not be donezo is ramping down meat production and maybe getting some really good meat substitutes, because, like, vegetarianism is going to be a hard sell for a lot of people.
That is
I think you're
very
right, though, about just the kind of sense. It was super neoliberal.
The market will
stunning.
Save us.
Yeah.
Oh, no. We're going to democratically plan production.
Okay.
Don't worry.
And we're
going to
get this all done
well
in 12 years. Within 12 years, no problem.
Meat production.
The state should be financing all of that right now.
The state is, it's like everything else. The state starts it, and then it's privatized. That's how it works.
Matthew, let's get to your pick.
Yeah. So
it's from Denmark.
It's this film that Netflix produced called Okja. Has anyone heard of it?
Okja.
It's like isn't John Ronson really somehow involved in this?
Don't you mean okra?
No, that is the southern fried delicacy vegetable, which is delicious.
It's also
an
Indian delicacy as well.
But no, this is by a Korean filmmaker, Bong Joon-ho. He made movies like Snowpiercer and some other kind of sort of dark sci-fi type movies. And this is, I think, one of the most incredible movies made in the past 10 or 15 years. It was released directly by Netflix. And it has amazing actors in it that you know, like Tilda Swinton, Paul Dano, Steven Yeun from Walking Dead, Jake Gyllenhaal. And it is in a mixture of English and Korean, so it's kind of a multinational production. But it is one of the most affecting movies about factory farms, I guess you would say, but it's also that sort of selling it short, because it is a kind of like, if Spielberg made a film about the horrific conditions of factory farms. So it's got this kind of sort of idealistic side to it, but also this really cutting sort of sardonic sarcasm kind of, you know, satire side to it. And I just want to read you a quote from the director who I think is amazing, this quote. He said when making this film, films either show animals as soulmates or else we see them in documentaries being butchered. I wanted to merge those worlds. The division makes us comfortable, but the reality is that they are the same animal. And he later in this interview he gives goes on to say, all of our problems arise because of capitalism. I was going to get there. It brings pleasure, but also so much pain and unhappiness. The questions I ask in my films about why we harm the environment or animals all comes down in the end to capitalism. So, and again, it's going to sound, I make it sound like it's this like intellectual political statement. It's this highly emotional, affecting, hilarious movie. And it's basically about this kind of super pig that in the future, this is sort of a not too distant future kind of movie that is developed by this corporation run by Tilda Swinton's sort of mustache twirling CEO. And it's about, you know, the fight of these, both the owner of the pig who raises it and the members of this sort of corrupt but sort of well-meaning animal liberation front group who try to free it. And I don't want to tell you any more about it because it is just madcap, but it is also one of the most just tear-stained viewings I have had in a long time.
Wow.
It is devastating when you start to really fall in love with, you know, the most charismatic animal ever to grace the screen, and it's a CGI creation. But Okja,
is it as good as Babe?
I mean, obviously, it is as good as Babe. But it's got this sort of sci-fi political sort of satire to it, which makes it, to me, a cut above your normal animal love.
That actually sounds great.
This sounds extremely relevant to my interests.
That sounds amazing.
Oh, well, good.
Wow. Tilda Swinton is in a relationship.
It blew me away. And I think it really affected my choice of what to eat. I like a four legs, no go. That's my new phrase.
Have you ever been to the farm sanctuary in Woodstock?
I have not.
It's pretty cool. If you want another emotional experience with animals, I highly recommend it.
I prefer my experiences mediated by the screen, but I might do that.
If you go back and find the That's Bullshit series that I did about 6 or 7 years ago, I think it's still on our YouTube channel. The picture
I did the opening.
Yes, that picture of the bull is from the animal farm sanctuary up there.
Interesting tidbit for fans of That's Bullshit.
Now, I guess I in retrospect, I exploited that bull. But
not the worst way it could have been exploited.
But yes, not the worst. But I was up there. It's actually a very cute place to go up there. It's good for the kids. Tough to eat a pig after that.
Well, I got to say, Okja, it literally, there's like a demarcation in my life before I saw Okja and after. So if that's enough to recommend it to you, I say go for it.
Matt's sitting there like, put me down for a definitely not watch.
But like Matthew,
burgers.
You already, I feel like you sold that movie to Jamie, and I'm going to watch that as well. I want to watch it with the kids or no?
Well, listen, the kids, it could change their lives. Like it will definitely be affecting. So it is dark. You know, there are some scenes that are like just very hard to watch.
I gotta
love an animal. It depends. You know, I usually like to recommend the most horrible things for you to watch with your daughter. This one, I may say, just check it out first yourself.
All right. Well,
another thing I just want to say, just to sell you on the filmmaker. He made another
already.
Movie.
Take yes for an answer, for God's sakes.
All right.
Watch
all right.
It.
You're right. I'll save it.
I'm watching it. I mean, I've got it up there. It looks intriguing. I like the
idea. I just wanted to tell you that he hates his parents, and he puts that in the movies, too. So
all right.
I knew
sold. All right. Well done.
It's about not eating animals and hating your parents? I'm going to watch that immediately at the satellite apartment.
And how do you spell that?
O-K-J-A.
O-K-J-A, yes.
Okay.
Bong Joon-ho.
OKJA. And all right, well, Matthew Film Guy, as always, a real pleasure. Yeah. Why don't you talk about your eBay page one more time so that people can get over there? What is the what is the most exciting article, your top line article that you have on the eBay page right this moment?
Well, I have sadly decided to let go my brand new with tags Christmas gift that I got from Mary, Adidas Cleveland Cavaliers number 23 LeBron James, same type that he wears in the games, tank top and short set.
Why?
You can get it
for a low. Why are you doing that? I gave that to you, and what are you doing?
Because you know what? I don't go around dressing up like my heroes. Like, it's just not my thing. Like,
why would you
I love
do this
watching
before,
basketball. I love LeBron.
Why would you do this before Halloween? There's your Halloween costume.
You're LeBron. Jubron.
Yeah, I don't know. It's just something I don't.
Does Mary
I'm
know you put it on
jersey.
There?
It's just not my style.
Does Mary know you put it on there?
What's that?
Does Mary know you have it on eBay?
She's not happy about it.
I would bet.
Wow, you're a prick, man.
Jesus.
Wow, and that's coming from Michael.
But that's right. Why I wanted to go to someone who can really give it a good home, take care of it, treasure it. Because it was
my
fiance
got me
gift.
A bad gift. Would somebody in the rest of the country like to have it and give it a better home? Because I'll treat it with consistent contempt and disrespect because I don't wear my heroes' jerseys while I'm watching Danish films about incest that are really about technology.
I'm so glad I graduated into the Saul Rosenberg voice, too. I really feel great about that.
Welcome aboard.
You did when you were circumcised.
That's right.
Matthew Film Guy. Thank you so much for your time today. Appreciate it, buddy.
Man, it's always funny.
Thank you, Sam. Take care, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
See ya.
Matthew, I really want to see that movie.
Guy, ladies
yeah, it
and
sounds
gentlemen.
Super good.
It sounds really good.
Do we have a Jimmy Reefer Cake song?
We have a Jimmy Reefer Cake and Adam Rainstopper.
Okay. Oh, so. Yeah. Well, now, how do these guys hook up? Do we know the
I don't think we know.
Story
we, need
of
a,
this,
we need a behind the music.
Power duo.
Really, the Lennon to Miss McCartney.
We need a behind the music.
All right, let's hear it. What's it called?
It's called Saudi Arabian Killers by Jimmy Bin Reefer Cake and Adam All Rainstopper.
Wow. All
oh, right. Boy.
I like it already. We'll be right back.
All right. There you go. I mean, Michael wanted to do a little fact-checking of the song.
It was Abdullah that he bowed to, not MBS, unless there's additional photos. But Abdullah gave him a fat MC Hammer-style chain.
Yeah, maybe Jimmy Reefer Cakes got access to some info that we don't have.
And I will also say that...
Definitely.
Citing Tulsi Gabbard and Rand Paul as if they were sort of lone dissenters in our support for Saudi Arabia, I think it's slightly inaccurate. In 2017, the Senate vote to not sell $500 million worth of missiles to Saudi Arabia was 53-47. There were about four or five Democrats who I think defected to the Republican side. And I think Rand Paul was one of the Republicans. If there were more than one, I think it was maybe only one.
Mike Lee might have defected on it too, but Rand Paul. But why don't you say, listen to Chris Murphy and Bernie Sanders? Bernie Sanders has been speaking more clearly on Saudi Arabia than anybody. And
well,
they,
I think Murphy, to be honest with you, has been there for a long time in
Murphy's
terms of
been
like.
Very good.
I mean, you
Murphy's
know, in terms good. Of like his, that's his one trick. And I don't want to say that's his one trick, but that has certainly been his trick.
Murphy's very good, but I just think it's really enraging to me. That especially now with this whole nonsense with Tulsi Gabbard, when Bernie Sanders really actually he is starting to articulate and piece together a full left foreign policy. I mean, Tulsi Gabbard has nothing to say about Lula. She has nothing to say about refugees. She has nothing to say about global oligarchy. I get that she's like a hero to the dum-dums, but there's still some problems there.
I will also say that even the House... I guess this is in 2007. That was when the Democrats controlled the House. Had voted to cut off aid to Saudi Arabia.
I remember.
So, I mean, this is.
Do you remember when?
Who did that?
You must have. You did it by accident.
There's a ghost in the machine.
I remember also when. I told you when Manchin was on with Cenk. And Cenk was asking him about funding the Saudis, and he's just like, I'll tell you what, Cenk's, here's what I'd say about that. I don't think they talk about collateral damage. It's not. It's killing men, women, and babies. That's wrong. I don't believe in that term. That's about killing innocent people. But I thought, Cenk's, you know, if we had U.S. advisors telling them how to use these weapons, that'd probably be a good argument, maybe an opportunity to use them safer. So I thought it'd be better that we're part of the process.
Nailed it.
I was watching that.
Constructive engagement.
Yeah.
That's what I call it.
It's like, you know, if we're not there with Boeing and Lockheed Martin, I don't think we're doing anything to help make that situation better there, Cenk's. And I say, you know, on the field and off the field, whether it's the Supreme Court or setting up a cholera outbreak out there in Saudi.
Jesus.
You got anything else for me, goddamn Turk? Because I go all day. I don't give a fuck.
Pretty smooth.
Yeah. Manchin is...
That's
the
why
ultimate
wins.
BS artist. That is why he wins.
All right, folks, we're going to take a quick break. Just a reminder, this program relies on you, its audience, for its support. Hey, when you become a member, not only do you get the extra content, you get the free show commercial free. So today you were treated to three commercials if you're a free listener. But if you were not, if you were a member, we would be 9 minutes right now. You'd be 9 minutes into the fun half. And I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to happen in the fun half. We're going to take some calls, but I'm also going to go through Paul Ryan's complete, like the way that this dude lies about Medicare. It shows the Republican desperation, but they have had luck with this in the past, folks. You remember the ACA.
Oh, this is exciting because the Paul Ryan material is going to lead to a second plug for Sam's new book as well.
What was
Blaming the Electorate?
Oh yeah,
Sam Seated.
Michael's very excited about
it. I am excited about that. I like it.
And all right, but so that's what members are going to get. So you'd be 9 minutes into it. You've already heard that if you were a member by now. I don't know how that's going to work in terms of time. I can't quite figure that out. But folks, join themajorityreport.com. It is literally pennies. I mean, a significant number of pennies. Not. I mean, so many pennies that you probably wouldn't want to walk around with these many pennies in your pocket. So in a way, we're doing you a favor when you become a member of the Majority Report. We're relieving you of walking around with 50 pennies in your pocket every single day. You are welcome. Also, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY. Get 10% off. Folks, today is Friday. That means that yesterday was Thursday. The day that preceded that would have been Wednesday, if I am not mistaken. The day before that is Tuesday. Tuesday has a night. On Tuesday night is the Michael Brooks Show. And who was here on Tuesday night?
Alex Perino.
Oh, you had the sniffles too, right? On
I
that
had the
day?
Sniffles. Right. Okay. Well, not for my show.
Right. Oh, you're much healthier.
And actually, I didn't even need to do sniffles because I texted you to say I was out. So I was fine.
You listen, here's a little, I'll give you a little tip, folks. If you're calling, if you're texting your boss to say, I'm not coming into work, don't put parens cough in between. The cough, the fake cough actually works much better when you're on the phone. Like, I can't come. You don't write cough, 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 comma, in parens. In the text.
I write cough, cough, sniffle, sniffle, wink. See you later. Oh, yeah, it's a real bad one. We talked about what the Democrats would do if they actually wanted to win, the long right-wing grift that's blown up in all of our faces. This coming Tuesday, Noah Changa is going to be on. We're talking on the from a ground perspective on the Georgia gubernatorial race, voter suppression, grassroots campaigns across the country. And this Sunday for patrons, an illicit history of the Congo Civil War, going back to the assassination of Patrice Lumumba with Milton Alamadi, whose crew and an Africa scholar, patreon.com/TMBS.
And Jamie?
So on this week's episode of the Antifada, we have a dialogue between Doctors Bones and Blumenfeld about the OG spook buster himself, Max Stirner.
There you go.
And for our patrons, as a special bonus, we have a bonus that just dropped today, where we get a little bit personal with our friend Jacob, who's an expat living in Berlin. We talk about how he triggered none other than Alex Jones, Glenn Beck, and Steven Crowder with his translation of the book Communism for Kids, as well as his guerrilla reading of The Coming Insurrection at a Barnes & Noble.
And Matt? Literary Hangover?
Literary Hangover, the completion of Volume 1 of Hope Leslie will be out tomorrow. It's a three-hour one, so if you're looking for some fiction to listen to, you can listen to me read it to you. That's it. That's only if you're a Patreon at patreon.com/literaryhangover.
All right, folks, going to take a quick break, head into the fun half. See you there, 646-257-3920, or you can IM the show through our app. Which is still hopefully we're waiting for iTunes to okay it soon.